Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. I hope you all are staying safe because it's very high time the COVID is spreading very widely. Please stay indoors as much as you can. So far we had looked at various MATLAB related codes. We had looked at the solution of Navier-Stokes equation. And as per your request, I have sort of highlighted two things. First is how to use functions in MATLAB, and second is about the implicit schemes. So because I thought that both of these aspects were sort of equally in demand, so I thought of covering both of them. So we'll start with the functions. So in this video, I'm going to talk about what exactly are these functions in MATLAB. So I'll start this lecture by talking about the various inbuilt and custom functions that are already there in MATLAB. And after that, having understood something about functions, then we'll talk about user-defined functions as to how you can write your own functions. And during this discussion, I'll also talk about why are we really needing for these functions. So you'll see that these functions will make our lives much easier. And also in the second part of this video, which is the core of this video as well, I'll talk about how you can use a user-defined function in order to simulate a very simple case of two-dimensional steady diffusion. So not only giving you the theoretical aspects, we'll try to implement that knowledge in MATLAB and try to see how that works. So without wasting any further time, let's get started. So let me start by talking some inbuilt functions that are already there in MATLAB. And because MATLAB is a very intensive mathematics-based software, so a lot of mathematical functions are inbuilt in MATLAB. So consider the example of the trigonometric function, that is the sine of an angle. So here we are calling sine of x. So MATLAB here, it calculates the sine of your function or sine of your angle using an inbuilt function. So they haven't explicitly told about it as to how they actually go about calculation of the sine of that angle. But from your experience, you know that if you put sine of 30 degrees, it yields half. So something goes in the background, but you can imagine that this is sort of a function that MATLAB would need, and it would calculate based on what your angle is. So the angle is your input, and whatever is the value of that sine of that angle, that is your output. So roughly a function takes some input, do some processing and gives you an output. So this is a general definition of function. This is not clear right now. Let me take another example, which is of contour f. So remember that when we were talking about two-dimensional visualization, then we had looked at the contour plots where we were feeding the various arrays or various matrix, and we were trying to see some visual outputs. So the contour f is a very good example of a function. So here you can see we use a command called as function, then in the large brackets we put some variables, we put a equal to, we put the name of the function, and in the small brackets here we put the arguments. So here this arg, that represent the arguments. So all the arguments that goes with the function's name, and whatever the outputs that we want out of that function, that basically stay here. So if you put contour f in your workspace or your command window or even in your script followed by certain arguments, then of course the contour f would plot a contour, but also you can extract certain outputs from that. So not only the function would do certain tasks, it is able to give you some outputs or some output variables if you are interested. So hopefully I'm not making things too complicated, but it would become much more easier by considering the example that we are sort of familiar with. So consider the case of a steady two-dimensional scenario. So we are going to our OneNote here, and we had discussed this a long time ago where we had a square domain, and here we had certain fixed temperature on these walls here, that is T equals to zero. And on the top wall, we had a temperature of 1. So we saw that the governing equation for this particular scenario is written here, which is the equation for a two-dimensional steady diffusion with constant thermal conductivity, if it's a thermal problem. And after applying the finite differences, specifically the second order finite differences, we arrive at this particular equation. That is, the temperature at a point I, j, it could be recalculated using the average of its surrounding temperatures. So hopefully you would have recalled that. If you can't recall it, please hit the link here that would take you to the video where I have talked about it. So now the idea is, we have already written a script there. Can we convert the same knowledge into a function? So let me talk about that in MATLAB. So the way in which I want to simulate this problem using functions is, because we have a fixed temperature boundary conditions, I define four different temperatures corresponding to four different walls, because in this case, we need that kind of information in order to solve the problem. Also, we could have an adjustable number of grid points. So n equals to 100, it defines the grid points in the x and y direction. And because the domain is a square domain and we are talking about square grids, so we don't have to separately define nx and ny. So here I'm going towards what might be the inputs to my function. So if I imagine this problem, I have four boundary conditions. So corresponding to that, I have four input temperatures. So if this problem didn't have a specified boundary temperature, then we have to think of something else. So because so far we have specified temperature at the boundary, so this is for that particular case. So having the boundary temperatures and the number of grid points, we might also need the domain size, because once we have the domain size and the number of grid points, only then we can know what the grid spacing is. So that is why I'm having my domain height or the domain length into the consideration. And these are all user inputs. So all of these variables can simultaneously be changed, and thereafter we can solve for the function. And the last variable that I'm talking or thinking about is the final error output. So remember, in this discretization process, we do an iterative procedure in which we keep doing the solutions or we keep doing the iterations until our error residual is resolved below a certain value. So hopefully this would not be new to you. So far we have got four temperature, some grid related parameters, and a error tolerance. So now the idea is how we can use these inputs in order to get that kind of final temperature output and also the contour plot. So here what I'm doing is, I have one output here, that is the final temperature, and I'm calling a function here, which is this is basically the name of my function, which I'll come to in a little bit. And within the function, I'm calling all these inputs. So I'm giving all these inputs here. So it is important that the function, the inputs that you are giving into the function, they have the same sequence in which the inputs are being asked to the function. So let me just go to the function which I have written. So I'll go back to this function 2D diffusion. So the way in which we write a function is, we write function, then in the large brackets we have the output. So here I'm calling that my output is simply called as t. So whatever the value of t would be, it would be simply stored in this t final. So you can see that we don't need to have the same numbering or the same naming for these variables, because the function is sort of global, so it doesn't need to have a one-on-one match with all the variable name. So you can imagine that somebody might say sine of a, somebody might say sine of x, somebody might say sine of theta. So that input and the corresponding output, they might vary, their names might vary. So that is why we're not concerned about that. So the important part is, we have one output that we are seeking here in this testing function, or this testing script rather, and in the function we have one output. And the second important thing is, after the name of the functions, we have these input variables. And again, the name of this input variable, as you can see here, I'm writing top, left, bottom, right, and epsilon. But in my testing script, these are called t top, t left, t bottom, and so on. So again, the namings don't have to be the same. The important thing is the order of those input arguments of these input variables, they have to remain the same. Otherwise, things might get here and there. So after this, the important part that actually goes into the function, I have written here, and I'll walk you through it, but you would see that this is actually very similar to what you would think of in a script. So because I have taken the number of grid points n and the domain height as my user input, from that I can calculate the grid spacing h. And using this, because I have got the grid spacing, again this variable here h is defined in the function. So remember that I am not defining the spacing here, and I'm defining the spacing directly in the function. So that is something you can also do. You can define certain variables within the function using the input arguments, because it would need those input arguments. So if you need to add any input arguments, you have to do that within the function itself. So after this part, we have these variables and boundary condition section, where basically I'm using this T variable, again the final temperature variable, and I'm defining the boundary conditions based on the inputs that the user would provide. So here the user have provided these values. So ultimately these values would be assigned to the temperature variable here. The rest of the script is pretty much the same as the of standard scripts that we have looked so far. So I write a statement called as numerical error equals to 1, so that we can continue this while loop. And note that in the while loop, I'm using this user defined tolerance epsilon. So this is the same epsilon. And when I would use this testing script, that would be 10 to the power of minus 7. After that, my calculations follow a very standard protocol, that I go from I equals to 2 to n minus 1, where n is the user defined grid points, and same for the j index. And I'm calling t new as the iterated updated variable, but my variable that is output is t. So it is important that towards the end of the iteration, I assign the new temperature or the updated temperature to be the same as the old value here. And because it's a fixed boundary problem, so I need to only worry about the interior points, and that is precisely what I'm doing here. So hopefully if you have gone through all these videos that I've painfully created over the time, you would be very familiar with this kind of coding script that I have been writing. So this is what the function actually takes in, and it does the calculation, and finally it produces the t variable. And within the function, I've also put a plot command. So basically the plotting goes for, it produces a contour plot. It takes in the x coordinate and the y coordinates, creates a grid using the mesh grid command, and basically just plots the temperature profile. So let me run this script. So I'll first run it for the case that we had looked before, which is zero everywhere on the boundaries except the top wall. And I'm giving a lesser number of points, that is 50, and we have a domain height or a domain length of 1, and for a lesser error, let us say 10 to the power of minus 5. If I run this script, basically this script would call to this function here, it would give in all the arguments, and it would produce a t final. So I want you to note what happens or what would happen in the workspace. So let me first clear everything in the workspace so that you can see that there's nothing here. Let it get cleared for a bit. It's still busy. Everything is cleared now. Let me run this here. And I want you to observe that the first thing would be we have defined the grid spacing inside the function. So notice what happens to that when I run the testing script. So I'm not running the function directly. I'm running a testing script which has the function or which would call the function. So this is the kind of plot that I hope you might have remembered. We have temperature of 0 at these three walls, and we have a temperature of 1 at the top wall. So remember that we had defined h within the function, and if I go to my workspace, you would see that h doesn't exist here. So anything that we define within the function, and if we don't take an output from that, so my only output from this function is the t variable, so that is why the h doesn't appear in the workspace. So if you want, or if you need that h or anything that comes or that is defined within the function, you have to have it as an output. So in this case, I was only interested in the temperature field, so I only took the t final as the output. And the important thing to note here is that is my t final here, and it is not t, the capital T which was defined in my function. So whatever happens in the function stays in the function. So This is the kind of input-output relationship that you might have to think about a little bit before you can write your own function. Hopefully this was clear. If you think that this video has been helpful, please consider subscribing to this channel if you haven't already, if you are a new user. And if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. This greatly helps me in order to produce more and more videos. In case if you have any questions, again, please feel free to write in the comments. I might produce another video or two because I know that this is not justified in order to give more idea about the MATLAB functions, specifically with respect to the application towards the CFD side. So I might write a little bit more functions where we can talk about the convection diffusion equation, or even if possible, if time allows, for the Navier-Stokes equation. But in the meantime, please go through this video, try to write your own functions. It's really cool. It's really very, very handy. So now you can imagine that if I have to run it for a different case, I can just change the temperature here. I can just change the grid points or anything, maybe just some less error. And I can quickly run the testing script or wherever the script that I want to use the function in. So this is very handy. Suppose if you are given certain boundary conditions and if you want to quickly use that particular part only, so you don't have to write that entire script within a script, because that is what the function is designed for. So again, you can see here that if I have two walls at same temperature and other two walls at other same temperature, we would have a different kind of temperature variations, which again could be predicted using this diffusion equation. So hopefully you would get an idea of where you can use it, because it would be very handy. Suppose you are writing a very big code and you just need a little bit of assistance by this two-dimensional diffusion scenario. So rather than writing and copying and pasting that entire script over there, in which you might have to worry about all the variables, while writing a function, you don't have to worry about that. You can only get the output of the variable that you are interested in. You can use the inputs that maybe you have obtained from some other process, feed into that function, and bang, you get the output. So hopefully I'm able to convince you to use the functions more and more rigorously in your MATLAB scripts. That is very handy. I always try to write my general functions so that I can use them somewhere else. So this is going to be a very good coding practice as well. Hopefully you learned something from this video. Hopefully in the next few days or next few weeks, probably I'll have another part to this functions where we'll talk a little bit more about that. Until then, please stay safe and take care.